minute, talk about our sponsors. Hi-Dive, Denver, Colorado. The tallest stage and the coldest beer. Everything is black. That's why we go there, Jack. The Hi-Dive, off of Broadway in Denver, Colorado. Sponsor number two, Mutiny Information Cafe, is a place where you can find all of your spankable material from horror novels written by such visionaries as Ramsey Campbell, Stephen King, Scott Smith, or T.E.D. Klein. That's Mutiny Cafe. Mutiny Information Cafe. Also on Broadway. Denver, Colorado.
And we're in Brooklyn. That's Paul's Boutique. Paul's Boutique.
Oh, thank God you're back. This was terrible without you. I just went into fake sponsors that are real places.
But they will be.
Give me a little bed of Eternal Nightmare, would you?
All right, coming at you from the Bluebird Theater in Denver, Colorado on December 7th. We've got Havoc, Violence, and Axe Slasher.
Hey now!
That's right, Havoc, Violence, and Axe Slasher, December 7th at the Bluebird Theater. That's 3317 East Colfax. I repeat, 3317 East Colfax. For tickets, visit AEGpresents.com or DM Axe Slasher on any social media for the friend and family discount. That's right, friend and family discount from Axe Slasher. DM us on any social media to see us playing with Havoc and the Mighty Violence.
Come
the creators
out,
of all things unholy. Every municipal waste riff you've ever loved has come from Eternal Nightmare and see them play it live. I saw them in Oakland, California. They were amazing. They destroyed. Phil Demmel is in top form. Sean Killian's looking good. You
the progenitor of nasally vocals in thrash.
That's right.
The guy who started that
the
shit.
The guy who started my favorite type of thrash vocal, which is the vocals that sound like they were recorded at a different time in a different room without hearing the song at the same time.
That's right.
So yes, please come see Axe Slasher, Havoc, and Violence at the Bluebird Theater, December 7th, Denver, Colorado.
Just got a package. I don't know.
Now I'm interested. Now we have to turn this into an unboxing because you've just gotten something.
And unbagging?
It's an unbagging. So you've gotten something in the U.S. mail. It looks like possibly a t-shirt of the black variety. Is this your Krayshawn t-shirt?
No. Vasivis. My Vasivis t-shirt.
Ah,
yes.
A long sleeve, and let's see the print on the side. Runes. Okay, sure.
Uh-huh. See? Look how different. Yeah. See?
I'll take it.
We always talk about this. You can't just put your goddamn logo in a on the side of the sleeve.
Yeah,
that's
it looks
bullshit.
Terrible. Yeah. It looks like you had no idea what you were doing. It really looks like baby's first t-shirt. Like, so, just don't fucking do that.
In the slam scene, that is ubiquitous, and it is embarrassing, and it's usually hot pink for some reason. I don't know what that's about either. But,
I mean, a few t-shirt tips for up-and-coming bands.
That's what you do on the side, right?
Yeah, if you want some merch consulting, I can help you out. But like,
they call him the wolf in the t-shirt industry.
I make your shit good. Well, that's good blue for you.
Yeah, I love this fucking...
Wiyaki organic brand yerba mate. Blueforia, that's what I'm drinking right now. Sponsor of the podcast, get yourself some Guayaque Yerba Mate. I like to drink it before shows or when I'm outside relaxing.
But Justin, they're not a sponsor of our podcast.
But they could be.
This is a horrible bet, and it's never going to pay off.
No, it should. Well, that means we're going to do it for 10 years. Seems to be our MO. Is this not working? Great, I'm going to do it for 10 years.
That's called Crypticus, yes.
Yeah, excellent.
No, yours is working. No, mine's working, too. It's just...
Define working.
Okay, define working. Joe Bob Briggs is a fan, and you did the credits music on Deathgasm, which he showed on his show. That's working. I think it's working.
I appreciate the sentiment, but I look at that as a fortuitous series of events.
See, that's the normal viewpoint. The magical viewpoint is you literally made that happen.
Yeah.
So it's your choice.
Manifest.
Yeah.
Well, you. Yeah, that's right. Your choice. This house is getting into chaos magic. I get it. I've looked into it a little bit.
This house.
This house. I've seen you guys take your magic sidebars where you don't think I know what you're talking about.
I believe in magic.
Pizza's hip. Pizza's hip. Ashley just received a wand, both from nature, and in the mail this week.
Wait. What do you? Oh, you mean she like an actual found wand?
Yeah, like the dog brought her a branch.
Oh, from the dog, it's even
better. The dog
better.
Brought her a branch after we, because I
her familiar.
I rented. Yes, the familiar brought her a branch. So I had rented. We had, our backyard was way overgrown, and it was to the point that there was no way to deal with it without renting equipment or buying a scythe.
That happens here too.
Yeah. So I ended up, instead of like paying someone, I got a bug up my ass and went to Home Depot and grabbed Alex Pace. We used his van and we rented this thing called a brush hog, which is basically it's like a lawnmower on steroids. And you remember how my backyard had those big old bushes, and then it also had like the super tall weeds and shit. Well, like, it literally just went over those bushes like a normal lawnmower goes over a lawn, and it just fucking destroyed those, all the trees. Like, I had the backyard and the front yard done in an hour with that thing.
Isn't this, what?
That's what I had and was taken to my lawn.
Like, the shit they use on the grounds of, like, an insane asylum or something. Those huge ones.
Yes. It's a brush hog, so it's like... It's like a giant lawnmower, but the blade is actually dull, so it can break bones instead of just slicing through things.
Oh, okay.
Well, and it's hydraulically powered, so it just bashes everything. So it literally just cut everything down, and now I can use a normal lawnmower on the place again. So it actually looks fucking 1,000 times better.
Well, you have that wooden fence between your front and back. Did you just say, fuck it, just go over the wooden fence? Just like, fuck it. I'm just
chew
gonna,
it up.
I don't have time. I don't have time.
And I went over that broken bench outside that keeps blocking the gate for you.
Just powder.
Yeah, it's powder now. I snorted it afterwards in victory. But this is fucking exciting talk. This is the cold open. It's lawn talk.
You know what the key is? Just the right bed of music will make this pop. Yeah. And it'll be the most hilarious thing ever.
It's the King of the Hill theme song.
Sure. Well, no, but that's what you were doing. You chose to man it up instead of just hiring a service.
Yeah, I figured Alex has a van. If he'll agree to my plan, which was I'll give him a McDonald's breakfast sandwich if he...
Oh, I'd like that. Oh, yeah.
He did.
I'll eat that.
He liked it. Breakfast sandwich. He got excited. And he used the brush hog. I used the brush hog. And we fucked up the yard and made it good.
Oh, when you said brush hog, it scared me. Oh.
It was big and it was intimidating to use, but it was fucking cool once I got the hang of it.
You and Alex should start a grind project called Brush Hog.
I don't know what you're laughing at. I'm 100% serious.
I literally have security footage of, like, me going over... Security camera footage of me going over the bush and then turning to him, and we both just go, Brush Hog!
You guys didn't have to just start throwing watermelons into it and stuff. You know?
Well, we had it for the entire day, so...
You didn't get your deposit back, did you?
We took care of the yard in an hour, and then we just ran over random stuff.
You didn't have to run over the neighbor's chihuahuas.
I actually did go into the alley and do my back and some of the neighbor's backs, too, just as a little, hey, I got it, why not? Beat him up, and it's a power trip riff. There you go.
So now, what you're saying that wait, hold on. Yeah. So you're familiar with this this Cro-Mags album?
Yes.
This, I guess, is the Cro-Mags album that everybody hates.
Yeah, there's a clear dividing line on this one for sure.
I guess it's because of the embarrassing hip hop elements. How's the volume there for you?
Sounds pretty good to me.
All right, I'm still my volume's a little weird. Yeah, it's the vocals on this album are weirdly Danzig-esque, I feel. Oh, let me see. Let me put that on the top there.
Yeah!
children are starving in the streets, yeah. Don't you see the signs, people?
In the streets, yeah.
Become vegetarian now.
Hare Krishna.
No, vegetarian's not enough for John Joseph. I follow him on Instagram.
That. Hare Krishna, go. Can't believe that.
You know there's
a... Hare Krishna, go.
All right, John Joseph and Harley Flanagan are both going to kick her. They're going to kick our asses.
And they're literally going to show up to a show and kick the bass out of my hands.
Do you know this album well, or are you
not well? But I'm familiar with it.
I really love it. But there's a. You were talking about the Hare Krishna part. This song, "The Path of Perfection," is the Hare Krishna song on
yes.
it. It's really great. I love it. I'll play it here. It's. I love the riffs on this album. Yeah, you're right. It's totally a power trip. Album. Yeah, listen to these riffs.
Yeah, no, Cro-Mags are like one of those obvious influences that Power Trip wears on their sleeve, but they do it in like a fresh, fun fucking take. But that's directly why there's so much crossover between the hardcore audience and like thrash audience
totally.
And a little bit of the punk audience
yeah,
is because of the Cro-Mags influence and from sound to riff writing and, you know, and it's fucking awesome lyrics. Like they're an awesome band. Fucking big fan.
I totally approach this, but like you said, from a... thrash angle. Yeah, to me. But yeah, his vocals are very strange on this
I'm
song.
I'm actually kind of enjoying doing the podcast standing up.
Standing?
Right now.
Like, this is our like practice to do it live?
Do a live show.
This is how the Bonfire does it. They stand around like this, drinking beers.
No, they don't.
Yeah, they do.
No, they don't.
What are you talking about?
I watch them on fucking YouTube.
No, they do live ones all the time.
Oh, okay. Yeah, gotcha,
like
gotcha.
At bars and stuff. And they stand, and they also do what we're doing, this weird shuffle.
Because you don't know what... Well, the thing is, we're both old. And when you're old, you can't put pressure on one area for too long.
What are you talking about?
No, I'm
old.
I'm old.
You're
enough.
Not old.
I'm old enough.
All right, old enough. Old eggnog, as they say.
Which that has such a great shelf life.
Well, this does help me crack all my joints now because
we're doing a.
We're also dancing.
Slow hardcore dance yoga.
Is this is this what we would do if we were doing this live? We would actually be this visual with our physicality. We play thrash metal behind us like. This?
I guess it's good that we're trying it in your room right now instead of in front of a bunch of people because this would be... I'd watch it, but I wouldn't be excited to pay for this ticket.
Well, I don't know about the silent just two guys talking. I would want music behind us like this but then we can make fun of shit.
You think that like some Johnny off the street coming in is going to be expecting karaoke, but we just keep talking over it? They're like, where are these guys going to sing? Fuck, man.
This is their act. They karaoke, but just talking over it. Like, it's a new level of Shatnerism.
It's takioki.
Oh, yeah, listen to this part. This is Harley's rap.
Oh, so this is where Jonathan Davis got it from.
You know what? Totally. That's exactly what it is.
Yeah, that...
I never thought of
what's that producer, Ross Robinson, that do you think he was feeding a little... Pass of perfection to John when he was giving him also the meth to make all those Korn albums.
That guy's nuts. Have you ever seen any documentaries about him? His methods.
Oh yeah, no. I mean, like, I didn't realize, and a lot of people didn't realize until pretty recently how instrumental he was in nu metal, even like being a movement. Like it seemed organic, which was like by design, because
right.
It's almost kind of creepy too, because he's like, you know, suburban youth needs an angsty voice, because you know urban youth has an angsty voice, so it's like almost kind of coded racism involved in it. But
interesting.
Not, I don't know, that's maybe reading too much into it.
No, I could see
but
it.
You could, like, I've been listening to a bunch of shit about Ted Kaczynski and Timothy McVeigh, so everything is everything is some sort of underground plot to get you to be a white supremacist in my book right now.
Wow, Ted addressed Ross Robinson in nu metal production. Huh? That's interesting.
Well, he told him that the white youth needs a voice, and whining is the way to do it. Wine rapping is the way to do it.
Speaking of which, this song.
Good. Some scratching.
Yeah, well, you were mentioning...
You can't hardcore dance to rapping or scratching, so I get it.
I'm sure it's been attempted.
At a Vane show.
Who?
Vane?
Vane.
You haven't listened to Vane yet? I'm surprised.
V-E-I-N?
Yes.
No, what's Vane?
It is...
I'll look it up.
It's a band of, I think, young dudes. Their sound is like super aggressive nu metal. like, but they play to hardcore audiences, so you can find some awesome, like, Hate 5-6 videos on YouTube of them and shit.
So they're bringing back, like, new metal styling?
To me, it sounds like new metal, and they to me, they kind of have a new metal vibe, but I think that a fan, like a true Vane fan, would call that, like, heresy.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, let's see.
They think that's an old man judging some bullshit.
Okay, this totally looks like some shit up your alley.
Shut up,
he says. Oh, that's cool. Okay, yeah, these Hate 5-6 videos.
This guy's amazing. The scene needs librarians, and this guy's a fucking documentarian librarian. This is amazing. This is one of the greatest resources on the internet, in my opinion, is these Hate 5-6 videos.
Yeah.
It really captures... It's one of the few videos that captures being there.
Yeah, they're pretty amazing. I watched that Power Trip one, like, over and over and over. I think it's amazing. All right. Okay, I can see there's a Cornish element.
Yeah. This is, like, their big fucking banger hit right now, too.
Vane.
I mean, it's aggressive, so it still gets a pass in my book, but there's definitely stuff that, like, younger me would be sus of. Now I'm just happy if you're fucking aggressive, and these guys do bring aggression.
Yeah.
Like, that's pretty Deftone-y.
Yeah, the vocals even are getting a little... I could see it. Yeah, yeah.
But I think it's the perfect... Like, I look back at when I was the age of all these kids in this pit. And I'm not super old, but I'm old enough, as we were discussing before. And I think about, like, when I was in that pit, I was worshiping stuff that was, like, reinventing shit from the 80s that dudes 10 years older than me were looking at going, that's just thrash, but re-thrashed.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, I think that new metal is that version now for me at my perspective and age where I look back and I go, oh, you're just doing kind of a new metal thing, but it's been long enough that might, it's fresh again.
Wouldn't it be amazing, though, if kids resurrect new metal now and make it fucking awesome, though? But they make it amazing, and it's actually, like, something that's not embarrassing to listen to, and it actually has, like, real, like, what if it comes back with, like, real legit hip-hop elements in it and stuff, and then actually this level of...
And, like, real message, because I think the big problem with new metal that makes it so embarrassing to listen to now is so much of it is, like, I don't know... I know this sounds insensitive, but a lot of new metal songs are just kind of like suck it up songs where it's like, yeah, you could sing about this every night or you could suck it up. And I feel like a lot of the problems that new metal musicians write about are suck it up problems.
I guess. It's interesting to break down genres of metal based on which problems they're addressing. Oh, Jesus Christ, this is just...
Yeah,
this is corny as shit. And I mean that with a K.
The K-corn.
Yeah.
I mean, look at the Vane Army, though, showing up with the fucking rain slickers with the Vane logo all over.
Ooh,
it.
Jesus just Christ, fucking that dude got fucking knocked
pummeling
out.
People. Oh, that dude just fucking straight up punched someone. Ooh,
yeah, they are doing a lot of diving into a very empty
this is the July,
pit area.
The July 30th, 2017 Vane Sid on Hate 5-6 is what we're watching
right now.
If
you kids at home want to follow along.
Yeah, if you want to pull it up, the pit. Like, even if you're not a Vane fan, like maybe you're older than me or Patrick and you listen to the show for whatever reason and you're like, nah, fuck all this. Like, look at this crowd reaction. Look at these fucking kids releasing this energy. Like, there are... long, deep-seated problems being worked out in this pit right now, and that's something that I think is a beautiful thing.
Well, the thing that fascinates me always is how you can continue playing when there's so many people jumping around you on stage and climbing up and shit and knocking your shit around.
Yeah, I get
it, because they're so good at it. Like, especially in that Power Trip 856 video, like, there's so many people on stage, and it's like, man, they're unplugging their shit and stuff.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
That's the risk you run. I've never had to deal with it myself, but it looks like a fun problem to have.
Yeah, well, Axlasher has zero tolerance for bullshit on stage. I'm letting everyone know that.
Yes. Speaking of Axlasher on stage, you can catch us December 9th?
This is a big deal. You're playing
I gotta check out the actual date on it because
here, hold on, let me turn this down a bit.
That's a big deal. That's a big deal.
Yeah, I'm pretty fucking excited
about
it.
That's gonna be just in terms of your scrapbook, that's it, maybe.
This fucking silly project that I started in my bedroom at your behest and inspiration and guidance has gotten me
guidance only. Guidance only. The inspiration.
You inspired it. You inspired it. Because otherwise, I was just going to wait around for another band. Which, considering...
Oh, you mean wait around for another group of people to start a band? Oh, I see. Or to join someone else's band.
Exactly. Yeah.
Oh, I see. Well, yeah. Everyone needs their own band. That's my theory. Everyone.
And then other bands are just other people's one-man band. I mean, that's the world. Sure. Honestly, the more professional in the metal scene you get, that becomes like a more and more common situation because it's kind of like rare to find someone who has the flexibility and schedule to tour, you know, kind of whenever the label wants you to, and also like maintain a life outside of that.
Yeah, I guess this is, well, in the, if I can, Andy Warhol shit, yes. In the future, everyone will have their own band in their own bedrooms.
We all already have our own TV channel, as he predicted, so. Well, it's Instagram TV.
You just somehow took your, we would sit on the couch, stone, and talk about violence and shit, and now you're going to play for, uh-oh. Folks, here comes the landlady. She's got that bomb ass pussy, as they say on the streets, or as her T-shirt says. This is Jenny Vaughn. She's here.
Hey guys, what are you doing?
This is what's going on. Just started. Pass my mic to you.
I got business to attend to. That's
what kind of business do you have to attend to?
Reefer business.
Reefer madness.
That's right. So feel free to.
Well, you know, Pete's going to be playing with violence here.
I bought my tickets.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that.
I pay for my art.
Yes,
thank
you.
Yes,
actually, Jenny is a great super fan for any bands out there that are looking for a super fan because she actually supports the things that she listens to. She tells people about it. She forces it down unsuspecting people's throats. She is a beacon of promotion for any bands in the Denver area. If you want the 40 people that listen to this podcast to know about you, tell Jenny.
That's real. Jack Brown came to a local show with me the other night at...
He's been popping up at more and more.
Yeah.
Nah, he's like a...
Well, let me set up who we're talking about because nobody knows. Jack Brown is a friend of the podcast, if you guys don't know.
He's been on every episode except...
Oh, has he?
Oh, okay, so they might know who I'm talking about.
Possibly, Jack Brown, who's not here to defend himself, which is how we like it.
Perfect.
Yeah.
He was nice enough to come to a small local show with me. There were some out-of-state bands, but it was at Seventh Circle.
Shout out Seventh Circle Music Collective. Formerly Blastomat in the good old days.
I had not been there since it was the Blastomat.
Shout out Aaron Say. Shout out Seventh Circle. Shout out all the volunteers.
Yeah. Great space. Jack Brown came with me, hung out with me for the first band set, and then proceeded to take phone calls for the rest of the show.
That's actually how Jack enjoys music, I've noticed, is that he shows up, catches a song, and then spends the rest of the night outside on his phone.
Instead of coming and talking to me, he tied his shoes.
I love Jack Brown.
I love him so much.
He's a very strange feller. I always feel like I'm trying to like put my hands around smoke when I'm trying to talk to Jack Brown because he's there for a minute and then he's gone.
That's Jack.
Again, we're referring to past guest and friend of the show, Jack Brown, who if you go back a few episodes, you can find out who we're referring to. He's been on the show before. Friend of the show, Jack Brown.
Please, nobody knows who we're talking
about. Yeah, no one knows who Jack Brown. No. No.
Literally
Jack
everyone.
Brown has more friends than we do.
Everyone knows Jack Brown. Everywhere I go.
Half of our episodes are about Jack Brown.
Well, secretly, see, this is his, he's man on the mooning us. He's secretly made this podcast all about him, and he's not even in the room right now.
Damn.
He's a powerful wizard, and we don't even fucking know it.
That's what he's doing down there.
And outside.
Yeah.
Right now.
He's not smoking.
He's gonna
walk in on
us.
He's burning sigils.
You know, I'm going through a pretty heavy dungeon synth phase right now.
As
so,
you do.
So, talking about... My
what?
Focus is on sadness.
Perfect. Excellent. Great for a comedy podcast.
Yeah.
But dungeon synth is cool. I mean, there's a whole section of electronic music that's like creeping in to cool territory and acceptability for metalheads, in my opinion. So what dungeon synth have you been listening to lately?
Fogweaver. Shout out to Fogweaver, Denver band, Denver dungeon synth.
Shout out Fogweaver.
Wonderful. Great. Based on some fantasy novels.
Search it on Bandcamp. You'll find it.
It's a project called An Old Sad Ghost that I like. I like it a lot. They're spooky. They're very spooky.
Old Sad Ghost. That sounds like something that I'd write in a notebook and come back to and be confused about. A lot of the modern electronic music, much as we were talking about Vane being a repackaged and beefed up new metal, a lot of electronic music is doing the same, where they're drawing influences from 10 to 20 years ago. And
Youth Code is just Skinny Puppy.
Yeah, I've felt that too. Like KMFDM, Skinny Puppy. My exposure with Skinny Puppy and KMFDM is dating a raver in ninth grade, so I don't have a ton of like experience there, but I know that you, Mr. Bruss, are a Skinny Puppy expert.
Well, Jack Brown is the expert. I'm just a fan. Skinny Puppy's amazing. They have amazing albums.
I always looked at them as like big enough that it's trivial to mention them on the podcast because enough people know about them already. All I know is that like every goth girl I was attracted to in high school really liked Skinny Puppy. Shout out Owlbear. How's Owlbear going?
Oh, Owlbear's great.
Hi, Bobby.
Obviously, Dungeons & Dragons themed barbecue here in Denver. Killing it. We have a lot of vegan options for my veggie friends.
Yep. Jenny herself is a vegan chef.
Vegan working in a meat eater's world.
This sounds super happy to me.
Sounds spooky.
To you.
It doesn't sound spooky to me at all. It sounds happy. I'm just saying the reputation that they have is spooky and creepy, and to me this sounds like, I don't know, the Halloween version of Aha.
But look at like Depeche Mode too. Goths love Depeche Mode, and there are some of the they say some bleak things, but their music is pretty happy.
They say like robot bleak shit. The way a robot would look at the world and go, I guess this is bleak.
Robot bleak should be a new subgenre.
Robot bleak, robot glitch. It all has to be made by a neural network, which you basically just point at Bandcamp and make it learn everyone else's song. Hi, Bobby. Who's a sweet boy? Bobby is a beautiful English bulldog who really likes to lick my arm and hand.
He loves licks.
He's a very good boy.
He's a sweetheart. God sent us an angel. Because God is real.
That's a controversial stance on the podcast.
I don't want to start any blasphemous rumors, but...
Can I request a change in soundtrack? Anything. What are we watching here?
Dracula.
This movie was rated R for sexuality and nudity. If that's offensive, this isn't your movie.
Okay.
That's the caption.
Do we get to see her get naked? Because she's a babe. She's the granddaughter. How does Dracula have a granddaughter? I don't think that their semen works.
Dracula fucks all the time, though, but he doesn't reproduce.
Angel did have a baby with Darla in the third season of Angel.
No, I don't have enough Buffy knowledge to keep up, but have your own segment where you just talk about individual Buffy episodes that people should watch.
I could.
Give us a rundown of the top Buffy episode that people should watch.
The top episode? Like number one episode?
Yes.
I would say Hush. Hush. It's season four, episode six or seven, I think. There's literally two lines of dialogue in the entire episode because the demons steal everyone's voices so that they can steal their hearts in their sleep. Definitely the scariest monsters that have ever been on Buffy. I think that's kind of unanimous. Everybody thinks so. Pretty great. Nico finally got me to listen after 10 years of hammering Coheed and Cambria into my head. I'm listening to them.
No, not them. This is getting cut.
Not Coheed and... Oh, Jesus.
But just for like, you know, it's just been like a day of that. It's just been like a day of that. I went through a little bit of a depressive black metal phase. Just to shake my depression.
Okay, I like precisely one Coheed and Cambria song. And, yep. This is their only good song.
Which one is it? Let's see if
you'll immediately know it.
Oh, yeah, I've heard that one.
It's the one
I've still
where
only
he
heard
goes,
a couple of their songs. Their albums.
You know that one? No, this one has great guitar playing.
Okay, he did a really cool cover of Adele's Hello.
Oh, well, yeah, okay. I could see. Well, this guy is. I make
he's pretty
of,
incredible.
Yes, he's an amazing musician. I just can't. His weird, whiny vocals are too bizarre for me.
That's what kept me off of it for literally 10 years that my friend was trying to get me to listen to it. But
yeah,
I'm listening past the vocals and just the musicianship, and it's pretty fucking good.
You know what this is called? This is a Rush situation where you are defending nerdy music with whiny vocals because it's proggy, and you just gotta listen to the musicianship. This is totally what Rush fans say, and Coheed and Cambria are absolutely the modern Rush.
Okay, well, catch me listening to Rush soon, I guess. All right.
This is just a condom through which you can like Rush, which I'm not saying that's bad.
Fine. That's
I'm just,
fine.
Yeah, I'm just saying. I think maybe
can't
now.
Can't have that raw Rush yet. I went into a band camp rabbit hole of one-man bands, which is kind of my favorite thing anyway. There's a lot of great ones. That one you tweeted about, the Outer Tormentor. That one-man slam band.
Yeah, oh, geez, his shit's awesome.
It's
weird.
Really, really weird and good.
Yes, I especially like when people are making very bizarre death metal, and it's a one-man project. But, yes. And I don't think that dude even has CDs or anything. I think that's the only way to get it is...
it's all on Bandcamp. I bought two of his albums on Bandcamp, and he made me his fan of the week on Instagram.
Oh shit!
He was so excited that somebody actually paid for his music.
Well, gee, that's funny, Pizza, because I bought his stuff too, and apparently he looked at my photos and didn't make me the fan of the week. I wonder why that happened to bomb ass pussy over here.
I did let him know that I heard about him via Crypticus.
Okay, well thank you.
And then he retweeted your tweet. I don't know if you saw.
No,
that.
Yeah. I'm just saying though. It's just.
I'm more than my avatar.
No, but you put out some really, really good photos. Like, come on, I'll tell you that much. Oh, what is this? Jesus, this is in the Daughter of Dracula. Listen to this shit. This is great.
Ooh, look at those pants.
Yeah.
You got enough white claws in you?
I have to keep this chemical balance here because this shit's fucking killing me. Here.
What is he doing?
He's dancing.
Is that
Jenny?
How they
that's,
used to dance?
Yes, that's called seduction. You wouldn't understand it these days. You guys, this is what we used to do, a timeless dance of seduction like this blonde man in extremely tight pants is doing to this lady in a what is that called?
Dancing like a door spring.
He's dancing like a door spring, as Pizza says.
And, what the fuck
this is
doing?
A Nocturna Granddaughter of Dracula from 1979. It's very sexual right now.
Is this disco?
You know, this is totally disco. Yes. It is 1979. Let me see. We are.
I used to fuck after.
This is. She's so this, turned this on.
This is
look at
fucking.
Her. Yeah, they weren't. They still weren't allowed to fuck.
Come on. Come on. Everyone was fucking in the 70s.
Look,
that's when
dress.
Fucking was developed. Or at least
perfect.
Oh my god.
I bet none of these men know that women are capable of having orgasms.
I don't think you're giving the 70s enough credit.
I mean...
I think the 70s was when women first became allowed to be orgasmic, you know. Like,
they're still not allowed to be orgasmic.
What are
Shameful.
You talking about? Like, you're having one right now, I thought.
Yeah.
You're sitting on a ball, like an inflatable ball. Mm-hmm.
That's how it works.
There's a fan blowing on you. I thought, isn't that all it takes?
Yeah.
That's what all this
stuff is. Yeah. Wining and dining, you got me a LaCroix.
One of Jack Brown's. No, wait, that's an outside LaCroix.
This is my. I brought my own LaCroix. Why didn't you like Midsommar?
Pizza. Pizza and I went saw Midsommar with some friends of ours, and a pizza poo-pooed Ari Aster's sophomore venture here.
Dislike so
just some just some bullet points.
Yeah,
we don't have to get into it.
It's a very frustrating watch because it's still difficult to tell, in my opinion, if he's super talented or hacky and getting lucky. And
I feel that. That's how I feel about David Lynch.
Yes!
Oh yeah, Ashley and I just watched. Well, she watched, and I caught glimpses of the third season of Twin Peaks, and that was watching her go through that ride. It looked so frustrating because I'd come down and there'd be nothing happening, and I'd look at her. I go, "What happened?" She's like, "Nothing." And then the episode would end, and she's like, "Boy, they've got three to go, and I hope something happens." So then I'd go do my thing, and I'd come out from trimming the yard or something, like, look at it, like, what's going on here? Nothing. Okay, well, is there, like, have they foreshadowed any? She's like, not really. And I would catch 10 minutes of it, and it couldn't hold my interest. And then when it was over, she was like, I'm disappointed I watched that. Like, and she's a huge fan of Twin Peaks, like, yeah. huge Twin Peaks fan. David Lynch fan, but she was like, this was a waste of my time. Like, there wasn't anything fanable about it.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's Twin Peaks, which I didn't see and I gave a full review of. Maybe we could talk about Midsommar, something I did see and haven't really talked about anywhere. Like I said, I'm more interested in talking about things I like, even though I can't really hold myself to that standard. It's one that I try to. But I felt like Midsommar, it approached certain things that, like, to be truly horrific, the big scene that everyone always talks about, I think that it could have been done in a way more horrific, scary way that wasn't, like, kind of slapsticky, that solidified, like, that moment as true horror and not, like, a silly pixie's trick.
Okay. I just thought it was beautiful. I mean, I thought the practical effects were incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah, some of the practicals were cool, but then a lot of the, I had issues with a lot of the CGI effects.
But I also just liked how, I personally liked the slapstickiness of it. I think that that made it... It seemed like something that could really happen, that really happens, I guess.
But you could make it horrific and seem like something that really happens too, like...
I see that. I feel like you also analyze movies a lot more where I feel them. So, it evoked a great deal of emotion. And I also spent the greater portion of the last 3 years dating a horrible... emotionally unavailable man. Excellent. So that definitely hit me hard.
Okay, well that's Ari Aster said he wrote this movie right after a breakup.
Yeah, I could totally see that. And I've also dealt with a great deal of, like, familial trauma and loss.
Yeah.
So
very recently too, condolences to all of that. The fact that you're here smiling and talking about Midsommar is appreciated and not unnoticed, so thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Well, cut all that out.
Please do.
So nicely touching. I'll cut it all out.
Please do.
But I liked it, and I thought, I mean,
how long is this scene? This scene in Dracula's golden age.
I think this is all that this movie is.
Just one long dance scene in a disco where someone's supposedly the granddaughter of Dracula.
I mean,
where are you madly in love?
Okay,
I'm in love with this woman.
So yeah, Ari Aster. I want to see more movies from him. I have seen in multiple interviews it's going to be a while before he comes back to doing another horror movie. So we'll see what his other movies are.
The Strange Thing About the Johnsons?
No.
Strange Things About the Johnsons?
No.
That is a feeler. That'll give you some fucking feels. I think you would like it, actually. You'd probably like it more than Hereditary or Midsommar.
No, I liked Hereditary. I really liked Hereditary.
I loved Hereditary, but I am also queer for Toni Collette.
There's a metaphor that I like that...
Is it, we all have crotches? Is that the metaphor?
No, it's not that.
You know. We all have crotches, don't we? We all have crotches, and those crotches have requirements. You don't like my metaphor?
I don't like your crotch.
What's wrong with my crotch?
Why do you have to have it out when we record? Please cover it.
I told you, and I told Jack. The whole reason I wear the kilt is because I want you guys to see it.
But do you have to point the oscillating fan at it?
I'm airing it out. Otherwise, my pearly penile papules will
that's
will
what
crest
those are.
Over. I have
that's
to air
what
them
those
out.
Are. Gotcha. And that's why you have to have the sad lamp and
that,
point
well,
it
not,
right at
that's
it.
What that is. But that, but this right here, this is something else. Right here.
I wasn't going to mention that.
That's a little HPV. Yeah, this is a little HPV that I got from that girl from Chernobyl.
Boy, that is a prominent.
Oh, so you're saying this right here isn't deadly?
Nah.
I can...
Nah, you burn that off.
Oh, I've tried. It just keeps getting bigger. Well, the more I burn it, the longer it gets.
Burn it harder. Hey, well, I mean, the longer it gets, that's not so much of a downside in the penis department.
This is the part of the show that always involves us talking about the dimensions of parts of us.
Are these segments Me Too-able? Because technically we're... talking about our genitals in people's ears without their consent. Just be like, hey, audience, you want a glimpse into Patrick's kilt?
they have no idea that I really do wear. I wear this filthy kilt that I've had for many years now.
It's never been washed.
It's old. It's honestly been washed like maybe once, and it's. I don't even think it was. It's dried from then. That was years ago. It's never dried. It's. Yeah, I totally need to buy a new one. It's a sport kilt. I ordered online many years ago because I'm a lazy, lazy man. I need. I'm like Easy E, baby. I wear it for easy access. it has pockets. It's
which most dresses do not.
It's not a dress. It's not a dress. It's not a dress, and the part that clips to the front isn't a purse covered in fur. Okay, it's all very
your furry front purse. Got it.
You gotta do like I do. You wear a death metal shirt up top. And then that goes down, swoops down elegantly into a full gut. And then below that ample gut, ladies, is a filthy, filthy kilt. The
dirtiest kilt you've ever seen.
It's dirty and frayed, and the pockets have like pipe burns in them.
I like your new attempt at love here. You just be really honest on the internet.
I've always tried that, and it's always not worked for me. So I'm looking forward to more of that. But like you say, one day I'm going to find love through this podcast.
Yep.
And that'll be good love, because it'll be honest love.
Know well, she'll know everything about
who I really am, yes. Like these hoes, Justin, these trifling hoes, come after me just because they want Crypticus money. You know, all that Crypticus money.
It's embarrassing, really.
I know.
Well, yeah. Also, I mean, fuck most men. Especially straight white men, present company excluded.
Who says we're straight, baby?